Hey, you're listening to On the Health Record. I'm your host, Oleg Kujikov, and today I'm speaking with DrChrono's VP of Product, Sean Ahrens. Sean has founded and worked at various startups over the years. He's gone through Y-Combinator two times, first with his MessageParty app, and then with his first healthcare startup, Crohn-ology. He'll break down those experiences for us, how they led to his role as head of product at IBDPartners, and eventually DrChrono's VP. We also discuss his not-so-unique-anymore experience doing remote work. He's been working remote since 2014, so it was interesting to hear his thoughts about what it was like before and after COVID. Finally, we widen the scope to gather his thoughts on technology's role in healthcare and where it still has room to improve. Hope you enjoy. Let's roll the tape. All right. I'm joined today by Sean Ahrens. Sean is a health tech entrepreneur and product leader. He founded Crohn-ology, a website which enables patients with Crohn's and colitis to contribute to a democratized medical research network by chronologically tracking their symptoms and treatments. After this, Sean served as the head of product at IBDPartners, where he led the team to build similar technologies for peer-reviewed clinical research at the University of North Carolina. His research is published in two prominent medical journals. In addition to working in health tech, Sean has worked as a software engineer, UX designer, and product manager at various organizations. He's graduated from UC Berkeley with a Bachelor of Science in Business Administration and a minor in Computer Science. Sean, thanks for coming on the Health Record. We're excited to have you and get started.
Thanks, Oleg. Happy to be here. Thanks for having me.
All right. So, you know, largely this interview is for listeners and myself to get to know you. Let's start here. Where'd you go to high school?
I grew up in a small town called Camarillo in the greater Los Angeles area and went to a high school in the neighboring town of Oxnard called Rio Mesa High.
Got it. And what were you into back then?
Oh, what was I into back in high school? I played tennis on our varsity tennis team. I was pretty into math, physics, and chemistry. And back in actually middle school, I started fiddling around with building websites. And this was when I was about 12 or so. A classmate of mine named Ben had built a website, and I thought it was the coolest thing back then. This is back in 1999, roughly. And he had a website that was just things that a middle schooler would be into, things like Dragon Ball Z and like just posting waves and MP3s at the time, just like this new concept of MP3s came out, and we could upload those to different GeoCities servers and then just share those with our friends. And so I actually copied the source of his website and then just made my own website and modified a lot of his source code to make it my own because I didn't really know HTML and CSS at the time. And that's basically how I learned, just copying his source code and then manipulating it until I made my own site. And it was actually my friend and I, we worked on it together, and we called the website The Underground. And The Underground was, I guess, like you could think of it as a blog. It was a early website where we shared like jokes, like ladies in our middle school that we were attracted to, and we did immature things like make fun of people that we thought were worthy of making fun of, which, you know, I'm not proud of. So I guess we were early.
Well, you were in middle school.
We're middle school. We're internet bullies in middle school, essentially. But no one else in our class, the whole like middle school class, you know, knew how to make websites. So it was really cool. We could give a URL to our friends and they could, you know, it was like our own little publication that we could share and, yeah, have people view when they were at home and on AIM, and we could, you know, message them to check out new updates that we did to it. So that was kind of my early start of working with websites.
Really cool. And then so you go on to go to UC Berkeley, you studied business administration as a major and computer science as a minor. I'm actually kind of curious, you know, why didn't you do computer science as a major if you were building websites? How did you choose your major, business administration?
Yeah. So actually in high school, my junior year in high school, I realized the power of coding after doing those websites in middle school, got a TI-83 plus calculator as most students did then and maybe still do now. And I realized that it was actually a mobile computer because you could actually write apps for it. And so when I was a sophomore and junior in high school, I started writing my own apps for the TI-83 calculator. Some of them were games. I would make like little RPG games. I got maybe some members of your audience might remember the game Drug Wars. I wish I could claim that that was my game, but it wasn't. I built a similar game where instead of trading drugs and becoming a drug lord, you were a Matrix character, one of the characters like Neo or Trinity, and you needed to train yourself up to have the skills in order to fight the big bosses, the agents. I also made little utilities so that I could like track my grades. So in each course, like I would put midterm grades and final grades and stuff like that. And then it would show me my GPA on average because I was trying to become valedictorian, although I got a B+ in my visual design class, which was like a painting class. And then that kept me from being valedictorian in my school. And anyhow, once I discovered the power of coding, I decided that my school didn't have a programming class and I wanted to learn how to code more. I wanted to learn how to make visual interfaces on computers. And I actually took a summer school class at Ventura College, our neighboring community college. And I think the only other people there were all community college students. And some of the people asked me, like, why are you here? You're like a high schooler. And I was like, I'm like into programming. And they just thought I was crazy because they were in it because they had to be in it.
Right.
And through that course, we learned programming, the C programming language. I guess through that experience, I knew I really loved the power of programming, of what it could do. But when I was close to graduation from high school, I realized I didn't really want to sit in front of a computer writing code all day, even though I could do it and it was something really fun. And I really struggled with deciding what I wanted my major to be in college because I felt like the path of becoming a programmer was going to be really boring unless I was writing my own software. That's the conclusion I came to. And so business is what I majored in at UC Berkeley, even though I feel like this computer science was just constantly like calling my name and telling me to go pursue it. But I also knew that at UC Berkeley, I believe it was like the number three, or probably still is a number three school in the nation to study computer science at. I realized if I chose to dedicate my college towards computer science, that I was going to have no college life whatsoever. And I also realized how important college life was for friends and the social environment of all of that, that I think I pretty much, if I had gone to an easier school that wasn't UC Berkeley, I might have studied computer science, but I just realized computer science at UC Berkeley was just going to destroy my life. So I avoided it. And instead, I majored in business. And pretty quickly after starting doing the first year of business coursework, I actually discovered that I found the business coursework way too easy and way too boring. I'm actually not that interested in the finance aspects of things. I was really studying business for the purpose of becoming an entrepreneur and using my coding skills to create a tech startup. And most of my other students in my class at UC Berkeley at the Haas School of Business, I actually was kind of like, I was unimpressed by, most of them had no technical skills and they wanted to be startup entrepreneurs as well. But I was sitting there in class knowing how to code, being webmaster for my fraternity, having built an internal Facebook in 2005-06 for my fraternity. And then I'm sitting around a bunch of people that just want to hire coders to build their dream. But meanwhile, I'm sitting there and I'm like, I can build this and this business stuff isn't that hard. I just want to go take a swing at it. Mm-hmm. And I think it was through that kind of revelation, I realized, actually, maybe I've underinvested in computer science. Like maybe I actually should go get that degree to prove to other people that, look, I can do this. And that's when I decided to pick up the computer science minor.
Got it. So you kind of talked about, you know, not having a life if you were to major in computer science. I mean, it sounds like you were busy with the major plus the minor, but, you know, you didn't major in computer science. You'd have this extra time to have a life. What were you doing outside of classes when you weren't, you know, taking courses or crushing exams? Because I know you kind of graduated with high honors and also community fellowship awards from Berkeley. So yeah, what were you doing outside of school?
Well, a large part of outside of school was partying, as someone in college does.
Right.
I was in a fraternity, and which surprises most people when they know me, because I'm not your fraternity type so much. There's a couple things. Like, one, I was battling an illness in college, Crohn's disease, which I had been battling since middle school. And so actually, I did have to take a semester of medical leave off from UC Berkeley to get my health back in order. And on that note, I took a semester off of medical leave my junior year of college, because basically what happened was that right before I went to take my final exams, I couldn't get out of bed in the morning. Like, with Crohn's, you aren't digesting your food properly, which is then causing you to have a deficit of energy. Let me back up and say, you know, what is Crohn's? Yeah. That's important and not everyone knows, but it's a subset of inflammatory bowel disease. It is an autoimmune condition that causes inflammation throughout your digestive tract. And for me, and a lot of people, it comes in flare-ups where you get very symptomatic over the period of months, causing very excruciating abdominal pain, diarrhea, and bleeding. And if that goes untreated for long enough, you're just going to lose a bunch of weight and have no energy, just be super lethargic. So I tried to wake up to go to my final exams. Like, I'd gone through the entire semester and I just had to do these finals, and I was doing great in the classes. There wasn't any problem there. And then I literally couldn't get my feet under me to get to the door to go out to these final exams. So I missed my final exams and decided, okay, I need to take a semester off school so I can get my health back together. And the funniest thing happened is that as soon as I had filed for medical leave, it was like the next day that my health was completely back at 100%, which with Crohn's, stress can be a big factor that causes these flare-ups. And so I think it was literally by just lifting the burden off of me that I had to be doing all this schoolwork and that the next semester was going to be just as hard, that my symptoms all went away. And I had a decision to make, which is, how do I want to spend this whole semester that I have now taken off? And I decided to join a tech startup in San Francisco, and they brought me on. I was an intern with them the summer prior, and there was a welcome open door for me to come join them full time. And yeah, I worked with them as a product manager for about 4 or 5 months before needing to go back to school. And in that role, it was a luxury media company that really catered to super high net worth individuals. And so we were kind of like a luxury magazine put on the web. And in that, we were a guide for a lot of people of making large purchases, things like private jets and giant vacation homes, things like that. And as a pilot, I got my license when I was 19. The CEO of the company said, you'd be the perfect person to build our private jet marketplace. You can think of it a bit as a classified or, you know, an online listing of private jets, you know, which is ridiculous and whatnot. But I knew how to code. I knew how to design stuff. And it was funny because I was just like this college student that was thrown into leading a team, a designer and a programmer, to build that application. And yeah, we shipped it within those 4 months. And I was literally just given, the task I was given was build us a marketplace for private jets. There was no specification beyond that. And it was up to me to figure out what that meant, turn that into requirements documents, and then get that built out, which I was proud of what we did in that short period of time.
Awesome. And so you got good product experience, and I'm sure you would take that to, you know, your first role once you're out of school. Let's talk about it. So sometime after college, you co-founded a company. It was called MessageParty. Yeah, how did that get started?
So in my fraternity, I became good friends with a guy who was a senior when I was a freshman. His name was Marcio, and Marcio ended up going off to MIT, where he met a few other students that were quite interested in building a tech startup. And shortly after graduating UC Berkeley myself, Marcio reached out to me and asked me if I wanted to join and could help this little startup that they were getting started. I was skeptical at first because it didn't seem like they had a lot of clarity on what they wanted to build. It was initially like a social news site, kind of like Dig, where people upvote articles, with the spin that it was going to be college campus based, kind of in the same way that Facebook took off starting on college campuses. The idea that we would have a news site that was specifically for students at a particular university, and we could kind of create this news feed for that university and then expand out from there. I joined them as a software engineer to just help them as a consultant on the side. And they didn't really have strong technical talent on their team. It was just three founders at that time. And only one of the other persons was technical. And he was actually just getting started with coding. So they really needed me badly. They applied for funding at Y Combinator. And I ended up staying up all night the night before their Y Combinator interview to build them out the prototype of the product that they were applying for Y Combinator for. And then we were at a hotel room in Palo Alto, and then I said goodbye, let them go out the door to go to their interview. And then they came back and they said they got in. And at that point, you know, they realized how much of an asset I was to helping build their tech that they invited me again to join them as a co-founder and go through Y Combinator with the team. And I said yes, and that's what we did.
Awesome. Amazing experience. Let's talk about Y Combinator while we're here. How was your first experience at Y Combinator? Kind of take us behind the curtain there.
Yeah, so and this will be like a little bit of foreshadowing, is I went to Y Combinator again a couple of years later. So I've seen Y Combinator from in the summer of 2010 and the summer of 2012. And in the summer of 2010, which is this experience I'm just describing, is I think we had roughly about 80 other founders in the Y Combinator program. And for those who don't know, Y Combinator is a seed stage investment firm that specializes in giving funding to founders that, at least at the time when we applied, giving funding to founders that have no funding at that point. It would be their first money in for a lot of founders. And they help startups get off the ground, and then they build a pipeline of investors for those founders to then raise a much larger seed round or a Series A. There's been, you know, some big companies like Dropbox, Airbnb, who have gone through Y Combinator, among a whole list of others. Heroku is another. And I found the Y Combinator experience very exciting, because I feel like when I walked in the door, we were suddenly in this like back door of Silicon Valley. We were in this room where, you know, we got to spend time with Paul Graham. We got to spend time with a number of other partners that were, in our eyes, a bit of like superstars of Silicon Valley, and that they had the golden touch to make a lot of people successful entrepreneurs. And we were also surrounded by a highly selected group of founders and really talented technical people. And it felt really powerful to be in that room and then have some magnates of Silicon Valley come give us talks, give us advice about how to build our startups. And at the same time, I guess, and very much related to that feeling, is that, it felt like there was so much pressure on us. It felt like I had spent, you know, high school and college getting close to straight A's and being at the top of my class, to then suddenly being in this room full of people that I was pretty sure were smarter than I was and more talented and maybe had better startup ideas and maybe more traction in their startup. And it was really intimidating to be around people that I was pretty sure were going to be millionaires or billionaires someday, but I wasn't totally sure if I had what it took. And it definitely gave me a big sense of imposter syndrome.
Right. Yeah, I imagine it must have. Really interesting. I guess last question on the message party thing, and thanks for sharing your experience. What was your main takeaway? What was the lesson you took away as a first-time founder with MessageParty once it was all said and done?
Well, so to give a little more context, so with MessageParty, the reason we call it that is because after about three different product iterations we worked on, we settled on the concept of building a location-based chat application. And what I mean by that is, well, one, we were probably the butt of the Silicon Valley TV series joke that during a certain time, every startup was a solo mo startup, a social location-based and mobile startup. And we were totally that. We were all those things in one. The idea was that with a phone in our pocket, we could essentially send messages as if we were shouting in a public space. And if you were within an earshot or, you know, a certain mobile distance shot of that space, you could see the conversation that was going on and partake in it. So you could imagine things like sports stadiums, conferences, classrooms, reunions, meetings, et cetera, like anything where you're going to a physical location and the people that are in that location, giving them a venue for conversation, like automatically just based on their location, could be of value to them. That was our goal with MessageParty. And it was a good time for that type of startup. iPhone was still relatively new. This was in 2010. And a lot of the possibilities for the iPhone and other smartphones were still yet being discovered. Okay, what is a takeaway from that experience? One, that in some ways and during some times, getting money from Silicon Valley can be rather easy. I remember us just talking to some investor, and I thought at the time that we didn't have our stuff together. I thought we didn't really know what we were doing. Mm-hmm. But, you know, someone was just like, yeah, I'll give you $100K like right now. Thanks. Like, let's do this. And I was not convinced at our own pitch. You know, from the inside, there's so much doubt. And even just getting into Y Combinator is like a magic touch. And I think to get into Y Combinator, yes, so many people apply. And I think 3% or something like that get in each year. And at the same time, how much can they really know about you in like the 20-minute interview or 15-minute interview that they do with you? So I feel like there's a lot of arbitrariness to who gets money in the Valley. I think there's posturing, and very much the optics of what your startup looks like are really important. And to me, you know, it feels like a really unfair game. And I guess once I realized that, I realized that, okay, like just because somebody has funding, really, it's not a validation of their idea. I mean, maybe if they have the funding from the right investor, getting funding gives you a chance to have success, and it's really important. But people with bad ideas can get funded because there's plenty of money out there to be spread all around. And I guess to me, that gave me a little bit of a irreverence for Silicon Valley, like VC funding. I think like once I saw how arbitrary of a game it was, I kind of disliked it in a big way. And I think that actually gave me a little bit of a chip on my shoulder, which maybe prevented me after MessageParty from really engaging with that funding mechanism. And I became really focused on just building things myself as much as I could, and knowing that at the end of the day, my users were my guide, not my funding.
I mean, wow, you sound like, that sounds like it's right out of a product book, but let's keep talking about it. So you've kind of foreshadowed this very nicely. You're going to build something now for you and your users, right? So what's the next step? I'm teasing it out, right? You went on to found Crohn-ology, which was a platform or a network for people with Crohn's disease to connect and exchange information. Can you talk about that experience, what it was like building this? You're a founder for the second time now, building a company from the ground up. Again, talk about that experience and why it was important to you.
Yeah, so I had this idea for Crohn-ology since college, I think since my junior or senior year of college. And at that time, it was 2011, and about 3 years had passed since I had this idea. And I felt like it was about time I came back to it. And here's the idea, is that suddenly, and this has just been a few years since smartphones were in their full swing, every person living with a medical condition around the globe suddenly has the computing power and the interface in their pocket required to enable their personal experience living with their condition to be a part of medical research. And I realized that up until this point, medical research was all done through clinical trials and these observational studies, which required participants to explicitly enroll in them, make time out of their daily lives to go into medical research facilities, to take medications that weren't the medications that they would necessarily need. And the number of participants that you could get for those studies was very small, and it was very expensive. And meanwhile, I had been living at this point for maybe 10 years or so with Crohn's disease myself. And the troubling thing about Crohn's disease is that it is something that affects you daily. There's a sister condition called ulcerative colitis, and together Crohn's and colitis make up inflammatory bowel disease. and they collectively affect about one out of every 150 individuals. And so that puts you at about 3 million people in the US that are walking around with these conditions. But these conditions aren't well understood yet. And I, in my process of thinking through this idea for Crohn-ology, I also understood there's a whole host of other medical conditions which are quite popular that aren't well understood yet either. And it's this whole umbrella of autoimmune conditions. And in autoimmune conditions, rheumatoid arthritis, Crohn's disease, multiple sclerosis actually also fits in similarly into this space where they're treated with similar treatments. There's no cure for these conditions. And the treatment options that are provided currently by medical science are far from sure shots. At least in Crohn's, there's about a 30% chance or so that a given medication is actually going to work for you. And you may start taking it, it may stop working for you. And to add to that, let me say that diet, I had discovered through my own personal experiments, plays a large role in Crohn's disease. It's not too surprising. It seems really obvious, right? Crohn's disease affects your digestive tract. It's like what you put into that tract should affect how your digestive tract functions. But the reason I point this out is because every doctor out of like the six gastroenterologists that I had consulted with since having the condition had basically told me there was no evidence to support that any diets play any role in the condition. And actually, some of the diets that they suggested, which were pharma-sponsored diets, were super high sugar diets that I had tried and had totally failed me, had actually exacerbated my condition.
Right.
So you have this situation where you have patients online on web forums talking about how restricting certain foods actually were helping their condition. And by experimentally doing that on oneself, you could actually validate that to be the case. But then you talk to doctors and they say, diet doesn't play a role. We have no evidence to suggest it plays a role. And you should just focus on the drugs. And so it's discouraging because you have a population of people that could be helping you better understand the disease. But the way that we have built our medical research system is one that gives no credence to the individual patient to contribute that knowledge. And that is what was the idea behind Crohn-ology is, okay, what if I gave a tool sitting in each patient's pocket that allowed them to report how they're feeling on every day or whenever their symptoms change? And they can tell us about what pharmaceuticals they're taking, but as well as what experiments they're doing to improve this condition for themselves, whether it be through diet, through different vitamins or supplements, through different wellness exercises like meditation or yoga or acupuncture. I mean, as I mentioned at the beginning of this podcast, like I really was into the sciences when I was young, and I'm a firm believer in science. And I find that you have a lot of people in this world talking about how certain modalities of healing medicines can be beneficial for certain conditions, but not a lot of evidence to back that up. And what I really wanted to do was actually to create the tool that would validate or invalidate a lot of these modalities so that patients would have a really clear guide for what they should try. And by trying these things and recording those in real time, by essentially considering themselves as an N of one clinical study, that they could be contributing back to the world's knowledge on their condition to help other patients. And that was Crohn-ology, a social network of patients with the tools required for them to do their own personal experiments and contribute that to an aggregate set of medical knowledge for other patients to learn from.
Yeah, it's a really interesting concept and something you built and built a network from. Can you talk about how big it grew and start to finish? How did it go?
Yeah, so I'm a little bit sad about Crohn-ology because I built a thing that from a product standpoint, I guess I have to always humble myself as a product designer because self-assessing one's own product design is a heavily biased thing to do. But judging from the reactions and the growth of the network that we had, it was a really well-designed product that scratched an itch that so many people had that maybe didn't even know that they had, that was completely unaddressed by other products in the world and unaddressed by medical service delivery prior to this point. I mean, we had testimonials from patients all around the world of how this thing was blowing their mind, that this existed, that, I mean, we even through the emotional connection that a patient received and support from another patient, she was suicidal over the condition and found someone that helped pull her out of it. And she reported that as a testimonial to us. There was so much good benefit of this product. And the challenge was that we just were so underfunded. I brought Crohn-ology through Y-Combinator in summer 2012. I convinced an old college buddy to join me as my co-founder, and he convinced a college friend of his to come join us as a software engineer. And we got about 150K going into Y Combinator from Y Combinator and associated funders of Y Combinator. Then when we launched out of Y Combinator, we only reeled in about another 200K. And it's just like, at the time, I didn't realize how measly of a funding round that was. Mm-hmm. I was, you know, relatively just a couple years out of college, and those numbers, I didn't realize at the time, if I just applied my software engineering to Google, that I, you know, in a year I would make all that money. And so, you know, if you imagine that you have enough money in the bank to pay for one engineer for an entire year, you know, at Google rates, let's say, it's not going to get you very far as a startup. And so, I mean, just purely through blood, sweat, and tears and sacrificing years of my life towards this cause, were we able to build the product that we did. And at some point we came to a juncture, which was, we are going to need more funding if we're going to make anything of this, because the bank account's running really low. The problem that I ran into when I was raising the funding of our initial round was that I felt like a lot of the vision I had for our product was so geared towards altruistic purposes that when I tried to do the pitch for this product to venture capitalists, the framing of this through altruism of improving medical research and stuff didn't really land with a lot of people. And I think that's why we didn't get much funding. And really, you know, what they wanted to know is, how is me giving you this money going to, how are you going to become a $1 billion company? And how is this going to help me with a 10x return? And that wasn't the pitch I was describing to them. And when I did attempt to do those pitches, I found myself really outside of my comfort zone, talking about business models that really related to data for pharma companies, using the user data to help pharma companies. And well, I think there's an opportunity for that being helpful to drive democratized medical research forward. It's a narrative that doesn't inspire all of the patients that are contributing to this research and actually feels a bit of a betrayal to them. And that's something that I could feel personally just through myself living as a patient. But I also just couldn't imagine, I couldn't see how I could weave the narrative that would sit well with my users and inspire people in a Wikipedia-esque fashion to like selflessly contribute to a greater good, to a greater set of knowledge. And I felt like it was a very hard needle to thread to be building a $1 billion company, yet be building that off of the collective effort, individual patients around the world. And I ultimately became a bit distraught about how I would marry those two worlds, to the point where I realized I couldn't raise the next round of funding and, like, you know, and feel whole and feel true to what I actually wanted to do. And so I just basically laid down the computer or hammer or whatever the metaphor would be here, and just decided I needed more time to think about next steps forward. And as of right now, Crohn-ology, unfortunately, sits as basically a piece of abandonware at this point that I haven't been able to keep up with the maintenance on. And we had stayed live for about 6 to 8 years after we ran out of funding. And I would just donate my time to keep product updates going, to keep things from breaking. But at the end of the day, I mean, right now it's sitting in maintenance mode because I can't just keep sacrificing my own personal hours to keep the thing online, unfortunately. But to answer your question about how we grew, I mean, we grew to 30,000 patients with Crohn's and colitis throughout the world. And that was all organic. We didn't spend a dollar on marketing, and we did a whole horrible job of SEO. We just created an invite feature inside the app that allowed patients to invite their friends that also had the condition. And it grew from the patients that I had met in person in different patient groups, support groups in person in San Francisco and the Bay Area, the wider Bay Area, from like 30 people that I personally knew to 30,000 people over the course of several years. But I really think that's testament to the product we built. And I'm just sad that, you know, you can build a great product, but then if the funding's not there, it's not going to stay alive. And so maybe that's the comment I made about funding being so arbitrary, biting me in the butt right now. You know, it's arbitrary but necessary.
Yeah. Well, I guess that's lesson number two. It's arbitrary but necessary. But I'm going to ask the question, like, yeah, if your lesson from Message Party was funding does not make you a king, what's the next lesson from Crohn-ology?
Well, I think it's important. When I was building Crohn-ology, it was like 2011 or so, and I was still writing some of this early Web 3.0 kind of hype, which was, you know, your business model doesn't matter at first or whatnot. It's just about building usership and building a great product that people love. And that was something that was a theme that was common in Y Combinator at the time. And it was just common in Silicon Valley more broadly. And so the challenge with that as a mantra is that you can get yourself in a really tough situation. You can build something that is really valuable to a lot of people, but then just take them down this road that you can't figure out a way to monetize. And then you eventually have to shut things down, which was basically the road that I went down. And I now think it's super foolish to build something without having a good idea of what your business model will be, or a couple options for a business model that they might be. And I think I hid under that cloak of you don't, you know, just build a lot of usership and build a great product, to ignore some of the bigger puzzles that were actually down the road, like I said, around how do you build a network where people are willing to voluntarily contribute a lot of personal medical information, which is very sensitive medical information, to a cause that you're saying is a cause, but ultimately is a business at the end of the day. Is that motivation going to resonate? Is it going to still exist when you're building a bigger business? And I think you can see now with, you know, the tides turning against Facebook in a big way, that once companies become big, powerful, profitable businesses, that this concept of individually contributing to some communication, some database of information, something like that, isn't necessarily enough for people to still love the platform on which they're doing it. And I think it's hard to, in this space in particular, in health data, to gain people's trust. It's so hard. Patients have had their backs turned on by pharmaceutical companies for many years. And a lot of them, so I had an early front row seat to understanding this vaccine debate that's happening in the country, because I saw early on with Crohn-ology that we had two different types of users. We had users that loved Crohn-ology because it was about science and it was about contributing collectively to science. And we had other users that loved Crohn-ology because it was an alternative to pharmaceuticals for treating their condition, because they could gain validation and share support for alternative remedies that existed out there. And so you had this bifurcation of this like science-minded folks and these anti-pharmaceutical naturalist folks, which each totally has super valid points on both of their sides of why they feel the way they do. And I think the bridge that I was trying to build is we can have both. We can create, we can do science with natural medicines, and we can validate what works. And I bring this up because you have a large group of the people that I just mentioned that really have a big distrust for the medical apparatus as a whole. It's failed them. They distrust their doctors because their doctors tell them there's no evidence behind diet, so diet doesn't matter. You know, you have doctors basically seeing that there's an absence of evidence and believing that means there's evidence of absence, and applying that to their treatment protocols with patients, and not recognizing that maybe there's a set of things that do work or have a potential to work, but we just haven't studied those yet. And so the problem is that when you have a group of people, a large group of people that distrust the medical institutions, that working with them as business partners on the same platform through which these patients are finding an outlet for their stories and an outlet for their information offers some degree of incompatibility. And I don't think I was able to resolve that incompatibility and move forward with the project. And yeah, it's a sad state of affairs, but you know, I'm now working on new projects that I'm really happy about. And like I said, I look back on Crohn-ology in a really sad way because there was a really big possibility. I think like I want to be humble about it, but I also want to recognize the power of what was there. And I actually do see this concept that I described as being potentially technologically revolutionary to the human species for us to actually learn from individual people about their personalized medical state and medical data and apply that to the entire human race's understanding of medical knowledge. And that could greatly advance us as a species if done right. I got somewhat close to cracking that nut, I think, or at least I started cracking one part of the shell, but it's such a complex nut to crack that I didn't really get there.
Definitely. It certainly sounded like a very tough nut to crack. And you, I think, got another crack at it. Can you tell me quickly, like, what were you doing at IBD Partners and yeah, what you were asked to do?
So I was very fortunate that right as the funding for Crohn-ology was totally running out, that there was an initiative put together through the Affordable Care Act, which funded an organization called the Patient-Centered Outcomes Research Institute, or PCORI for short. And PCORI was a nonprofit governmental-funded agency, which had a mission of advancing research through patient-centered new technology initiatives. And Crohn-ology was a bit of a poster child in this space. I spoke at a number of different conferences, and I think that's actually what made me eventually having to abandon Crohn-ology so difficult for me, is that my face was all over this whole space, this whole Health 2.0 space, e-patient movement, the empowered patient movement. Like, what better story than a young programmer who has an incurable medical condition, who is building the next Facebook for solving this condition, you know, something of that sort, right? So I was plastered all over places and invited to speak at a lot of different conferences. And I was at the right place at the right time because there was a wave, which was this whole personalized medicine movement. And the Affordable Care Act put money behind that movement to fund PCORI. And PCORI put out a request for proposals for their money. And a doctor, a gastroenterologist out of the University of North Carolina named Dr. Michael Kappelman, had caught wind of Crohn-ology and reached out to me and asked me if I wanted to co-apply for a research grant from PCORI with him. And I said, yes, let's do that. Not only because I was running out of money for my startup, because I really wanted to see this idea through. Mm-hmm. And I wanted to maybe see if bringing this idea through a actual academic setting would actually bring it to fruition. And so Dr. Kappelman and I applied as co-principal investigators on this research grant. We requested $2 million in funding from PCORI. And 6 months later, we were awarded it, which was a miracle because, you know, it's in the single digit percentages that you would actually get this stuff, get awarded the grant. And yeah, Dr. Michael Kappelman and I worked together with a technology team out of the University of North Carolina to apply the concept of patient-generated research data to their clinical practice and their academic research practice at the University of North Carolina. And we built a website called IBDPartners.org in collaboration with the Crohn's and Colitis Foundation of America. And what was different about this web app from Crohn-ology is that we added several other sources of medical information from patients to the medical research database that we were building. And one of those was hardware wearables. We integrated with a number of different devices like Fitbit, for example, and heart rate monitors, that if patients were wearing these, they could register those and that data would go to the IBD Partners data bank. And the Crohn's and Colitis Foundation of America pulled in a genomic database as well to be a part of this research database. And we also had a network of researchers, which Crohn-ology only had a fledgling group of researchers that we worked with. But we had about, with IBD Partners, we had about 400 medical researchers around the nation that are all part of the Crohn's and Colitis Foundation's research network. And so the reach that we had with IBD Partners was one that was way bigger than with Crohn-ology. And we had researchers from around the country applying to use our data for medical research purposes and publish in peer-reviewed academic journals. And they've done that, and some interesting findings around diet have been presented as a result. I now have a publication in the American Journal of Medical Informatics Association as a result of this. And the IBD Partners project also presented some drawbacks. And those drawbacks were, from the patient perspective that I had with Crohn-ology, I programmed our initial application all myself for about a year. I had spent building Crohn-ology, and I could take any ideas that I had and instantly apply them to our code base, which was very informal, non-academic measures I was using to determine patient health. Like, I just asked patients, how are you feeling today on a scale of 1 to 100? But in the medical world, the academic research world, those numbers don't fly. You need to use clinically validated research measures. And oftentimes these clinically validated research measures are obtuse and difficult for patients to use on a frequent basis. And so in order to have our stuff be able to be peer reviewed and not be laughed at by academics, we had to adopt a UX that was cumbersome and didn't have the same friendly feel that Crohn-ology had, which helped spark its growth. All in all, I'm really happy with what we came together and built, but it wasn't the holy grail that I had hoped that, okay, maybe if I do this in an academic research setting, this is how I can achieve the vision. Like, even that had its pros and cons, and I still think that larger Wikipedia-esque vision that I was describing, I haven't found a way to bring that to life, unfortunately.
Yeah. Really interesting challenge. And I'm sure you'll be working on it for a long time. One thing I understand is that you worked in this role remotely from 2014 to 2019. If that's the case, then you have like 5 years on the rest of us when it comes to working with remote teams. Yeah, I'm just kind of curious to hear from you, in your opinion, like, what are some of the opportunities and then challenges that come with remote work?
Yeah, great question. I wish I had a really good answer for you, because I think I'm, even though I've spent this amount of time working remotely, I'm still a student of it. And I think now in my role at DrChrono's, this is the first time that I'm in a role where I'm working specifically with an entire team that is also all working remotely. When I was working with the University of North Carolina, I was one of maybe 30% of our team that was working remotely. And I think the challenges that I experienced then, a lot of them have been alleviated by the fact that now the world understands that remote work is a really big thing and that we need certain services to make that work well for remote workers. But back in the day, when I was doing this in 2014 through 2019, the social isolation was a big problem that I realized that I was suffering from. So because I didn't have coworkers to come in and see each day, I had to get my socialization and also ongoing education in my trade from outside of work. And so for socialization, I found that I really loved living in intentional community houses. And so I've lived in a number of them around the Bay Area. And so basically home was a place where socialization and chosen family existed for me. And then also, yeah, for ongoing education, I would do just a lot of Udemy courses, YouTube videos on learning new programming languages and user interface and user experience strategies. But yeah, it was really isolating. Yeah. Just talking about it right now, I can feel that level of isolation that I felt with working remotely then. And now it doesn't feel that way. It doesn't feel that way because now so many of my friends also work remotely that I've partaken in a couple different kind of, I would call them digital nomadic tribes almost. Like, it's groups of friends that all work remotely, but realize that we want to do that from beautiful, fun places around the world and during not working hours, really enjoy ourselves together. So I did this in Panama in May of last year, or this year rather, May of this year. And yeah, there's about 20 people and some people working on some well-known startups that I won't name that were all co-working from a beach in Panama, enjoying the beach life during the nights and the weekends.
Kind of amazing.
Yeah. So having more people doing this lifestyle means that I can socialize with those people and we are on compatible schedules again. And that was something that didn't exist in the quote unquote early days of remote working.
For sure. And yeah, while I believe you that the social isolation aspect has probably gotten better for you, it's still probably like a big challenge we could think about like across organizations that still certainly exists. So it's a great answer. I want to wrap up the interview by talking kind of broadly to you about working in product. You know, you've been working in product for many years. I tried to count, but I don't want to undersell it. So I'll just say over 10. And so you're probably, you know, very familiar with some of the challenges of working in product. Let's start with this. What makes leading a product team unique when you compare that to other teams like customer success or engineering or sales, for example?
That's a little challenging of a question because I've never led a customer success team and I've never led a sales team, but I have led an engineering team as a software, you know, I've been a software engineer, I've been a product designer, I've been a product manager, and I've basically just swept the field of different product and engineering roles, partly just so I have all of those skills, and partly because there are early startups that I worked for that I didn't even name in this interview so far. But basically, I've worked in founding level startups for so many years of my career so far that there's such a necessity to be able to do everything that I've run the field to build up those skills. Okay, what makes leading a product team different than those other organizations? My best way to describe this, I would say, is the level of ambiguity that you have to deal with. Mm. Leading a product team is like, it's kind of part like magic and part engineering.
What do you mean?
Well, it's like, yeah, what do I mean by part magic? You have to like have a vision for what your customers want. And there's not a document that you get to read that tells you what they want. Mm-hmm. The goal is build a product that users love. But like the strategy and tactics to get there, like you have to figure that out. And figuring that out is challenging because there's so much ambiguity of like, we could do anything. We could make this product do anything. Like, what are the limits of what we want this product to do? What's the box that you want me to work in to build this product? And how flexible are those edges of that box that you describe? Because I might discover that I could build a really amazing product outside that edge that you described. And do you care that I scribble outside of it? I think that's part of the challenge. The other part of the challenge is that users, and I've worked on a lot of consumer startups, and so they're extra challenging because what users want, they don't have as clearly defined needs as businesses, if you're selling to businesses, what they need. And so you kind of need to become like a user whisperer or a customer whisperer, and you need to get inside the head of not just one user, but sometimes inside the head of a super diverse set of people and what workflows they're trying to achieve. And in the context of Crohn-ology, as I described, like no one had a workflow they were trying to achieve. I was inventing a workflow and inventing the desire around here, if you did this workflow that I suggest you could do, that you could actually really help the world and help yourself and help other patients. And so I had to invent the idea, get people bought in on the idea, and then invent the workflow that would support the idea. And so it's so much just like a creative process of making something out of thin air in that context, that it's really hard to, it's hard to put a rigid process around. And I think one of the challenges of product management is that at the end of the day, it is what I just described there around building something that inspires your users, solves their needs. But internally, when you face inside your organization, you have this machinery that you need to turn and work with. And that machinery is your team. That machinery is the engineering team. The machinery is your scrum owners, your product managers, your designer, your engineering manager, your developers, all of these people that there's a process built around about how they get work done. And there's a whole business process about what your business strategy is and what work you're getting done and all the meetings that you have to take part of in order to make this stuff happen. And I think one of the big problems is that that machinery, just the operation of that machinery, can become too easily the focus of what a product leader is doing. And that stuff should be so secondary to knowing who your customers are, knowing what their needs are, and making a product appear for them. And the onerousness of turning that machinery internally in order to make that beautiful, magical reality happen can be a huge distraction to the efforts of the process. And often beautiful ideas can get lost in that machinery and never make it out to one's customers. So it's really about being a wizard and a machinist at the same time. And that's why I think the job is so hard.
Oh man, that's a good answer with a lot to unpack. I definitely have more questions, but I think we've gone over time enough already. And you've probably got better things to do with the rest of your day, Sean. So we're going to call it there. Thanks for doing this. Like I said, I have more questions. So maybe we'll have another one of these in the pipeline for sometime in the future. But yeah, thanks for joining. Thanks for telling your story and have a great rest of your day, Sean.
Thanks so much, Oleg. I really enjoyed chatting with you. Thanks for hearing out all of my ideas and thoughts. It's been great. Thank you.
That's it for this episode. If you enjoyed it, share it with a friend. You can also help us out by leaving a rating and reviewing us on Apple Podcasts or Spotify. We'd also love to hear your feedback. If you have any questions, comments, or ideas on who I should talk to next, you can email me directly at oleg.kujikov@drchrono.com. Thanks to everyone that helped put this episode together, including Elise DiNapoli, John Murphy, and Dan Kivitinos. Thanks for listening and have a great rest of your day.